All right, good day everybody, and today we're going to start our series looking into algebra. And algebra, again, it's a very interesting topic. It's something that, to be honest, we've been introduced very early in maths. Unfortunately, I don't believe that we as teachers sometimes do a good job at really bringing out the concept. So I want to draw a picture to you today, for you today. Today we're going to be looking at algebra, and we're going to be making some focus on the setting of the foundations for understanding the concept of the subject of the formula. So what are we going to do? First of all, I want us to have an understanding of the concept of algebra. We're going to see if we could paint that picture. Secondly, we are going to look at the subject of the formula. Today it wouldn't be all about math, we're just more discussing the whole idea of the subject of the formula. And last but not least, we're going to look at the characteristics of a subject. And the subject here, of course, I'm referring to that same subject of the formula. Good. So let's first understand the concept. Algebra is something that we've been introduced, as I said earlier, very early. Let's look at this. In a primary school or in primary institution, this might be one of the first signs in which we are introduced to algebra. That's what we see. 8 plus a box. Well, that's what we call it here in Grenada. You have a box, and that's equal to 10. And sadly, so they don't teach us any algebraic strategy to solve this. At the primary level, this is more of a guessing game. So it's like you have an 8, and you would think 8 plus what would give you 10? And that's how we solve our problem, right? Then we go to the secondary institution, and then we start to see things like this. A squared is equal to B squared plus C squared. But I wanted to notice that between these two, between the primary school here and the secondary school, there is something common. There is something we could say that is unknown. And I wanted to bear that in mind. In this case, we only have the box here. We know what is 8, or we know what 10 could be. Below here, we have A, B, C. And it's like, oh my goodness, A, B, C. What is A, B, C? We're going to talk about that later. But let's call them unknowns for now. And then when we reach tertiary institution or higher level, we might see things that we might get a little more intricate. And we see things like this. When we're doing limits, we have a sign there. Maybe we never see this sign before. Like, oh my God, what is that? Then we have an N. What is N? We have an N here, N here, N here. But again, these three things here have something in common. They all have unknowns. Yes? And we cannot deny that. Let's start painting that picture. Moving on. So, look at this now. Let's look at understanding. And I wanted to think of this scenario. This is a scenario I like to use a lot when bringing out the concept of algebra. And we have this scenario here. Your mother gave you $20 to go to the shop to buy a bottle of oil. You came back with $8 as change. That's all. I mean, when we do maths for CXC or whatever level, we always present it with a situation, a question, call it problem solving, call it whatever. Here we have a scenario. I have no questions, and I wouldn't put no questions to this. But without this question, or without any question asked, there are three things you could think about. Firstly, I could ask you, how much for the oil? How much for the oil? You got $20, you got $8 change. So a nice question to ask is, how much you paid for the oil? Algebra. Of course, I could also ask you, as obvious as it is, but it's a very plausible question, how much money your mother gave you? I think we could all agree, yes, it's given, but I mean, why not? It's a question. And last but not least, and again, this is all under algebra, how much change you got? That's another possible question. Yes, the answer is in the question, but how much change you got? But let's start to put an algebraic picture here now. So the first question, how much for the oil? I mean, putting an expression here, and maybe we could talk about making algebraic expression later down the line if it's needed. But putting the first question into mind, you say, okay, how much for the oil? We don't know how much for the oil. I mean, we know, I use simple numbers, so we could, well, I hope we could figure it out. But initially we don't. So then we have this scenario here. How much the oil would be? Simple. $20 minus the oil would give us back $8 change. And this is just thinking logically, putting algebra into the picture. The second question I ask is, how much money your mother gave you? And again, we could put that in algebra. And that would be this scenario here. Mother money minus $12 equal to 8. And this is true. And here we have the price of the oil. And it's not rocket science, but we're going to discuss how we could get that maybe in the next video. And thirdly, the question was, how much change you got? And here you go. This is how much change you got. 20 minus 12 is equal to the change that you receive. And this is the whole foundation of algebra. And again, I'm bringing back a word that I mentioned earlier. There is an unknown. Here, the first one, we have the oil. Oil is unknown. For the first one, the second one, we have the mother money. The mother money is an unknown. It's something that we don't know. Well, I mean, not that we don't know, but something that we don't know in the question. We could find out, and that's the beauty of it. And that's what I want us to start understanding about algebra. Whatever is not known could be found out, but there is always an unknown entity. And then last but not least, and this is very common to the point that when we sit like this, we don't even question that the change received is unknown. But it is an unknown because we have to compute. We have to do something to figure it out, as simple as this is. But again, I'm looking at the very basics of it. So let's look at it today now. What do we see when we do maths? I mean, if we see it like, oh, we just saw it, I mean, life is nice. But that's not always the case. What do we see when we do maths? So originally, I explained, okay, $20 minus oil is equal to 8. But in maths, this is what we see. And this is where the problem starts, or this is where some persons start to have a problem. 20 minus H is equal to 8. And to some of us now, we hurt our head about the H. But again, today, I just want to show you simple. The H is simply telling us here that there is an unknown. The H here is representing the oil. And I am deliberately using H because I think a mistake a lot of us make sometimes as teachers, we emphasize on X. Every textbook nowadays, sometimes, well, most textbooks nowadays, you see X. Everything is an X. Every unknown is an X. But I'm here to tell you that it could be anything. An unknown could be represented by anything. And I will deliberately avoid using X, the letter X today, so that we understand that the whole concept of algebra is just finding out what is an unknown, not X. Yes, X is commonly used. I'm not saying no, but it doesn't have to be. It could be anything. The unknown can be represented by anything. So here, our oil is represented by H. And a common question here they could ask us, no, it's fine, H. And later, we're going to learn algebraic tricks to solve this. But today, I'm just focusing on the subject. Let's get to the subject, the basics of algebra. The second scenario, we had mother money minus $12 is equal to 8. But in maths today, this is what we see. B minus 12 is equal to 8. And again here, the B is representing the mother money. It's an algebraic expression. It's an unknown. We just use a letter to represent that unknown. And lastly, we had a very straightforward question. $20 minus 12 is equal to the change received. But in maths, you might see something like this. And this is what algebra is all about. 20 minus 12 is equal to B. There are always an unknown entity, sometimes unknown entities, but there is always a means to find out how to solve it. Notice that in each of these questions, and this one because it's simple, we know what is H, we know what is B, and we know what is P. But then when it gets more complicated, then some of us sometimes we get lost in transit because we miss the basic. What is the basic idea here? What is the big picture? Let's look at that. What is the big picture? In a nutshell, algebra is a very basic form. Algebra in its very basic form simply involves finding an unknown entity with what is given. And this is key here. You see this word here? Is key. Unknown and, I would also highlight this, given. You would never get stranded in an algebraic question because to get what is the unknown, to find out what is the unknown, you must present it with something. They will give you something. They must. They will. I've never seen a question where they ask you to find something that is unknown and you don't have the prerequisite to get what is unknown. They will provide you with it. However, the question here comes, can we identify what is given versus what is unknown? And that is often what poses a problem. And sad to say, we blame it on algebra. So notice with the question that I just did there, I clearly express what we got. We got $20 from the mother. We also got how much change we get. So a nice question that could have possibly come from that scenario is how much you paid for the oil. That would have been a more than likely most plausible question. I doubt they would ask you, I mean, unless they're really trying to test your observation skills or your analytical skills. I doubt they would ask you how much change you get unless it's a trick question and how much money your mother gave you. It was really straightforward. But how much did you pay for the oil is the unknown. And what was given in that case, we were given the mother's money and we were given the change. Is we know to put it together. And that will be called making an algebraic expression, basically, in order to solve that problem. But we're not focusing on that today. I'm just laying the foundation. Moving on. Let's now understand the concept of the subject of the formula. Oftentimes we hear find the subject, make X the subject, make Y the subject, find T, or whatever the case might be. But what is the whole idea of the subject of the formula? Let's see if we could paint another picture here. So simple, I could tell you straight up, and hopefully all these are formulas that we are familiar with. The first one is the area of a circle. That's a formula for the area of a circle. For the second one here, we have the quadratic expression, not expression, the quadratic formula. Very lovely formula. I actually like deriving this from the quadratic expression. And here we have a representation of what we call the Pythagoras theorem, or part of it. It's not fully like this, but it's already solved for C. And in all of these questions, we have something in common. The A, the X, and the C. I could tell you no. All these are the subject of this formula. But then you might ask, what is the subject? How do we know that is a subject? Then let's look further into it. The characteristics. To understand the subject, you need to understand the characteristics. And the characteristics, there are three characteristics I love to use that usually draws it home for me. The subject of the formula in every given equation, scenario, however you want to call it, must represent or must show these three things. It must stand alone, first of all. It must be positive. You could call that secondly. The other doesn't matter. There's just conditions that they must have. They must exist in the subject. And last but not least, the subject must be in the numerator position. And a nice comparison I also like to make sometimes with students, and again, this is just for perspective, for you to draw your own picture. I mean, there are many ways to look at one thing, and that's the beauty of maths. No one way for anything. Think about the subject in English. When we're doing English literature, when we're doing English language, the subject is often defined as the doer of the action, the protagonist, the main person. You could even think about a movie, the star. That is the subject. The subject sometimes is often stand alone in the sense that he does all the heroic acts, he does all the good things. He usually stands alone. And oftentimes, the subject is also positive. And by positive, what we could think about is usually a good person. Usually. Movies nowadays, they twist everything. So sometimes the protagonist in the movie is a bad guy or a guy that does bad things, whatever. Things change nowadays. But I like to use that comparison sometimes so that we could compare. Think about the subject, the main person, meaning that he stand alone. Even if it's a group, they stand alone. In maths, of course, it will be a variable, it will be an unknown. So it must stand alone. Or you could look at that as thinking that it is before the equal sign or after the equal sign by itself, or if I want to look at it. It must be positive. And in maths, when we say positive, we're basically talking about this sign here, positive sign. I don't mean the constant or the letter have to be doing something good, unlike the movies. But it must be positive, meaning that it has to have a positive sign. And last but not least, the subject must be in the numerator. And by numerator, I'm simply saying, if we have an A like this, for instance, that A must be in this position. When we're doing fraction, we have the numerator at the top, the denominator at the top. So naturally, if we have, let's say, the T standing for itself, the T by itself is in the numerator because it is understood if we have something standing on its own, is the same thing as if you make a fraction, that same thing is standing over one. So that is all we're saying here. Don't worry, it's not no rocket science. So generally, if you do the right things, normally, by default, it will end up in the numerator. But again, we will have tricks to make sure that that is the case. And let's crumb the matter now. Let's confirm subjects now. So we're looking at A here, as we said earlier. To confirm that something is in a subject, I usually like to have these three question tests. So you ask it, is the A standing alone? Yes. Is the A positive? Yes. It is understood. If there is not no sign in front of this, then it is understood that is a positive sign. And is A in the numerator? Absolutely. Because again, if we go to make this into a fraction, we will have A like this. So is A the subject of this formula? Yes, definitely, because it passed the three tests here. It is standing alone, it is positive, it is in a numerator position. We can say the same thing for X. Is X positive? Yes. If it was negative, you would have had a sign. It would have had a negative sign. If this was negative, we would have seen this. And if we see that, we know something wrong. So that would not be the case. Unlike the minus B. Look at the minus B, although the minus B have a whole problem there because it's not even alone. But then we know that is not positive. So the X here is standing alone, yes. The X is positive, yes. And the X is in a numerator. So is X the subject here? Yes, it is. No question about that. And likewise, C. Because it also passed these three questions. The answer for the three questions will be yes. Is the C standing alone? Yes. Is the C positive? Yes. Is the C in a numerator? Absolutely, yes. So all these three are subjects of the respective formula because of these three conditions that exist amongst them. Similarly, for argument's sake, we could look at the R. I could ask you, is R the subject? Oh, by the way, I could tell you, no, we could make it. And we're gonna be learning tricks in the following, in the upcoming videos to find out all the tricks how to make something the subject of the formula when it is not in the position. And that is the whole basis of algebra, shuffling around, playing around. And we're gonna start, as of the next video, we're gonna look at transposition. But for now, this could be a question, is R the subject? And then we could say, no, why not? Because it doesn't answer yes to these three questions here. Is it standing alone? No, there is a pi here and the R is with a squared. So the R is not alone. Is the R positive? Yes, it is positive. There is no negative sign surrounding or around this R before it. So it is positive. Is it in a numerator? Yes, it is in a numerator. Because likewise, we could say all this here is over 1. So yes, it is positive for R. Yes, R is in a numerator, but R is not standing alone. So if we wanted to make R the subject, all we have to make sure is that R is standing alone. And to do that, again, as I said, I'm going to be teaching in upcoming videos the various tricks and strategies to convert something or to make something in the subject, to make something the subject. So that will be a wrap for today. So feel free again to like, share, and subscribe. In the next video, we're going to be looking at transposition, as to how we can use transposition to make something the subject of the formula. Thank you for listening in. You have a good day. Enjoy the rest of your day. God bless.